Thank you, Kate, and welcome to Inside Politics. I'm John King. Thank you for sharing your Friday with us. One set of memos, two very different takes. Trump allies say James Comey's notes vindicate the president. Others see proof the president was nervous about what the feds knew and wanted the FBI director to make it all go away. Plus, Rudy to the rescue. The former New York City mayor, Rudy Giuliani, joins the president's legal team with trademark swagger, suggesting he can get the special counsel to close the books in a matter of weeks. And students across the country staging more walkouts, this time on the 19th anniversary of the Columbine massacre.
And why is it so important that you guys continue to have these events?
So no one forgets about it. You know, so no one forgets to change the law that something needs to be done.
Live to New York in a bit for more on those dramatic school walkouts across the country today. First, though, some big developments in the Russia meddling debate. The latest, the Democratic National Committee now filing suit against the Trump campaign, the Russian government, and WikiLeaks, alleging it was damaged by a conspiracy to hack its emails and then use them to undermine Hillary Clinton in the 2016 presidential campaign. The Washington Post first reported news of this lawsuit. Republicans already calling it a gimmick and a publicity stunt, but there is a precedent of sorts from back in the Watergate days. CNN crime and justice reporter Shimon Prokopez is working this. We also have with us CNN legal analyst Paul Callen. Shimon, to you first, explain this suit.
Right, John. So this lawsuit, this 66-page lawsuit, was filed in a Manhattan federal court just a short time ago, and it really lays out sort of what we already know, some of what's been out in the public domain, and how they allege and they assert that Trump curried favor in Russia through their family business, then how Russia worked with Trump advisors before the presidential election to disseminate some of the hacks, the emails that they were able to obtain from the DNC. Now, the Democratic Party says this was all part of a conspiracy and that the hacking and the other activities hurt their relationship with voters, chilled donations, disrupted their political convention, and subjected staffers to harassment. And then the lawsuit goes on to outline a lot of what we already know, some of the known communications between Trump advisors and Russians, and really the lawsuit names everyone whose name has been out there, who's come up in this investigation, from Roger Stone. Also, they're suing folks like Paul Manafort, George Papadopoulos, and others, all alleging a grand racketeering, hacking, and fraudulent conspiracy here, John.
All right, Shimon, stand by as we continue to track this lawsuit. Paul Callen, let me bring you in. Is there a federal case here?
Well, there's a very unusual federal case here. The real question, John, is will it be thrown out by the federal court? There are 11 different causes of action in the case. I think the most interesting theory is what we call a RICO theory. That's the RICO racketeering section that was designed by Congress originally to go after organized criminals. And they're using that as a theory to go against various members of the Trump family and people like Roger Stone and the committee to elect Donald Trump. It's a very, very unusual suit. There is some precedent because back in the Watergate era, as you remember, Nixon's committee was CREEP, the Committee to Re-elect the President, and they were sued in a lawsuit, but it was a very different lawsuit because all of the sections of law that are invoked here are different ones. They're computer fraud ones, they're hacking, they're RICO ones. They're all things that really didn't exist back in Nixon's time. I think in the end, though, it's a publicity stunt to get information, to get depositions and discovery that you can generate some headlines with, and I suspect it'll be tossed out of court eventually.
And we'll keep an eye on that. Paul, appreciate the legal insights. We'll watch this one, yet another development. Shimon, you stay with us. We'll be back to you in just a second. Now to another big debate and divide over the same issue. The Comey memos leaked within seconds of being sent to Congress last night. Trump critics see evidence of a president and top aides nervous, they say, from the very beginning about the Russia meddling investigation, and a president feeling out not only what his FBI director knew, but whether he would be willing to just make it all go away. But the president and his allies see nothing. James Comey memos just out and show clearly there was no collusion and no obstruction. That's the president tweeting this morning. Also, he leaked classified information. Wow. Will the witch hunt continue? Also this from the president. So General Flynn's life can be totally destroyed while shady James Comey can leak and lie and make lots of money off a third-rate book. General Flynn looms large in these memos and the debate over what they show. Shimon Prokopez still with us. Shimon, this is your life, this investigation. As you read these memos now public, what's the most significant takeaway?
So certainly the Michael Flynn, all the conversations that the president had with the former FBI director about Comey, though not new, there was some new details, not completely new, there was some new information. One of the things that sort of came to my attention was how the president raised this issue of Flynn's judgment, questioning Flynn's judgment. Of course, this all is related to his conversations with the former Russian ambassador. The other thing that I found particularly interesting was the president's continuing preoccupation and fascination with the salacious details of the dossier. We know that that really bothered him, that conversation. He repeatedly in conversations with Comey denied that any hookers were involved in any of these situations, denying that there was anything to do with a golden shower. You know, at one point, John, he told, the president told Comey that the hookers things is nonsense, but that Putin had told him, we have some of the most beautiful hookers in the world. I found that to be particularly eye-opening, though it does not say, Comey does not say in these memos whether or not the president actually spoke to Putin about this. But it's certainly an interesting line of questioning and answers between him, between Trump and the former FBI director.
Very nice, kind, mild word. Interesting. Shimon Prokopetz, appreciate the double duty. With me to share their reporting and their insights today, Eliana Johnson of Politico, Carl Hulse of the New York Times, The Weekly Standards, Michael Warren, and The Washington Post, Sungmin Kim. Interesting. The President of the United States talking to the FBI director. What do we make of this? And let me read that line. The president brought up the golden showers thing, and it really bothered him if his wife had any doubt about it. He then explained, as he did at our dinner, he hadn't stayed overnight in Russia during the Miss Universe trip. Twice during this part of the conversation, Reince tried to interject a comment about, it's redacted, whatever that was, Reince being the chief of staff at the time, Reince Priebus, and why it was even in there. But the president ignored him. The president said the hookers thing is nonsense, but that Putin had told him, we have some of the most beautiful hookers in the world. He did not say when Putin had told him this, and I don't recall, and then there's more redacted. Is this relevant to the investigation in any way, or is this just James Comey walking out of the room with the president saying, why is he talking about this?
Yeah, I think that those are some salacious details or some interesting, to use the word, details from his recollection of it happening, you know, a few moments after it happens. But the memos themselves largely just sort of confirm what James Comey has already testified under oath that the president said to him. And it's really just a reminder of his side of the story, which is that the president asked him in many words, can you please make this thing go away for Mike Flynn? I don't know what else in here is really new, and I'm not quite sure what House Republicans on the Intelligence Committee were really going for by pushing for these memos to get out, although I think for the public record, it's good to have them out.
And to the point about General Flynn, which is the more significant part of the investigation, the president's national security advisor served less than a month on the job. He has admitted lying to investigators about when they tried to get him to answer questions about his dealings with the Russians. He is now a cooperating witness in the investigation that the president calls a witch hunt and a hoax. This is interesting. This is Jim Comey talking about talking to the president about then National Security Advisor Michael Flynn. He then went on to explain that he has serious reservations about Mike Flynn's judgment and illustrated with a story from that day in which the president apparently discovered during his toast to Theresa May that something has redacted had called 4 days ago. In telling the story, the president pointed fingers at his head and said the guy has serious judgment issues. I did not comment at any point during this topic, and there was no mention of acknowledgement of any FBI interest or contact with General Flynn. This is one of the big questions in the investigation. If the president had questions about Flynn's judgment, A, why did he hire him and put him in one of the most sensitive jobs in the United States government? And B, why did he let him stay on the job for a couple weeks after it was clear that he was subject to a counterintelligence investigation?
Well, let me just say first, I don't understand all of the media attention to Comey's allegation that Trump was obsessed with all of these salacious details in this dossier. I think if any of us were briefed on a dossier that the FBI deemed important enough to brief the president on or brief any of us on that contained these explosive details about us, whether true or not, I mean, I would be obsessed with that. Even if it were not true, I would be completely obsessed with it. So I don't really understand that. And I do think the most noteworthy thing about the Comey memos are that they don't say Trump has done anything blatantly illegal. On the Flynn thing, I think it goes to Flynn's argument that the president isn't crazy or losing his mind. He's not senile. He's somebody of above average intelligence who's capable of assessing the strengths and weaknesses of the people in front of him. And I do think it raises questions about why he put Flynn in this job. But it's very clear, as we've seen in a number of jobs, that he's not hiring the best people, and he makes decisions and turns on people quickly. He's very aware of their weaknesses, and I think he likes to put people around him whose weaknesses he can poke at and who he can dismiss in an instant. I think he's sometimes threatened by excellent people.
Well, he turned out to be right about Flynn because he did have bad judgment on several levels, right? So give Trump some credit there. This reminds me a little bit the release of these memos of how the House Intelligence Committee handled the report on the FISA warrant. They thought that this was going to come out and somehow exonerate the president. And of course it doesn't. I mean, he immediately tweets no collusion, but there's no proof either way in there. And I think that's just the president's technique, you know, to keep hammering this message, no collusion, because that's really not at the center of these memos. And I do agree that they pretty much are in line with what we already knew, but they do make for pretty interesting reading, right, about how the White House operates in the inside here. But I don't think it changes the dynamic of anything in any way.
But in an odd way, Comey, like the president, is now, as I like to put it, in the eye of the beholder. If you support the president, the tweets, you'd prefer he wouldn't do it, but hey, he's cutting taxes, they're cutting regulation, you people stop obsessing about the tweets. If you're suspicious of the president, why is he, you know, is he trying to feel out James Comey there? Like trying to bait him, essentially. I think Mike Flynn's got bad judgment too. What do you know? You know, trying to get information. Further on that front is Comey also writes about a conversation with the chief of staff, Ryan Priebus, who comes to him, this is a little bit later, right after Flynn was fired, or Flynn left. They told him he was going to have to go and he resigned. And Ryan Priebus asked Jim Comey, do you guys have a FISA warrant? Do you guys have a FISA warrant on Michael Flynn? Meaning, are you listening to his conversations? Comey was asked about that last night by Rachel Maddow.
Is there current electronic surveillance under the Foreign Intelligence Surveillance Act of the National Security Advisor?
Mm-hmm. And you did give him an answer.
Correct. And then told him that the way that should work is you should go to ask the Justice Department. They'll figure out whether they can answer the question, and then they'll get back to White House counsel should.
So Comey gave him the answer and then said, but I'm not supposed to. You're supposed to go through a different process. And he defended that by saying, these guys were new. I figured I'd give him the answer in this case because he was going to get it anyway if he went through proper channels. And I told him to go through proper channels. So you can take that as Ryan Priebus is a political guy. He doesn't know how this works. It's a perfectly appropriate question for the FBI director until he found out there's a different way to do it. Or you can take it as the president's chief of staff trying to help the president find out what does Comey know about General Flynn and who else has been recorded if they're tapping these conversations. Which is it?
Well, I mean, if you look further in the memos, there is another scene where Reince Priebus and Comey are in Reince's office and talking and sort of talking through how is this supposed to work. So you do get a sense that this is sort of at the very beginning of an administration, these people who have never served in a White House sort of feeling all of these things out. But I think it does reveal the sort of chaos that was there at the very beginning that
yeah,
all of us who cover it know.
That's what transition is for.
That's
Once you're in the White House, you should actually know how these things work. Yeah. And once somebody tells you how these things work, I think you should go through the proper channels. I don't really think the corner cutting on Comey's part or on Priebus's part is acceptable.
All right, to the point you made a moment ago, and I think Carl echoed it as well, Congressmen Goodlatte, Gowdy, and Nunes, three of the House conservatives who've defended the president on this, issuing a joint statement last night, essentially saying there's no there about the Comey memos, and that's the debate that goes from here on. If you're going to watch the conservative media say there's nothing there, Comey actually exonerates the president, you're going to see other people raising questions about it. The person that matters most is Bob Mueller. We'll see where the investigation goes. Up next for us, start the countdown clock. Rudy Giuliani adds star power to the president's legal team and says this could all be over in weeks. Welcome back. It is Rudy to the rescue for President Trump's legal team. But is the former New York mayor already setting himself up to disappoint the boss? Weeks of searching for legal star power brought this big announcement yesterday. Giuliani taking a leave of absence from his New York law firm to help the president. Now, Giuliani, get this, tells CNN his job, most of all, will be to serve as the go-between between the White House and the special counsel's office. Giuliani knows Robert Mueller from his days as mayor, and even before that, they both served as federal prosecutors at the same time. But is he setting the bar too high? Listen to this. Quote, Giuliani said He's going to get a list from Mueller of what is needed to comply with the rest of the investigation as soon as he can. And depending on what is on that list, that compliance might go quickly, even as soon as a couple of weeks. Raise your hand if you think that Rudy Giuliani can make Bob Mueller close the books, say thank you very much, and go away in a couple of weeks.
I don't think this will be over in a couple of weeks. Nonetheless, I don't think this is the most terrible hire on Trump's part. I actually think it's pretty savvy. Trump has been wanting a lawyer who can, a TV lawyer. And Rudy both has a sort of 1980s legal mindset. Trump's head is in the 1980s, and Rudy is that. He knows the Southern District of New York. He comes out of there. He will defend Trump capably on TV. Trump trusts him, which I think is important in terms of having trust with your lawyer. I think it's a good hire on Trump's part.
I agree completely, at least in the communication, from the communication standpoint. You have a known face who's a good combative on TV to defend the president. The question is, what about in the court of law? And again, I think relationships matter.
If he can serve as a capable go-between with Mueller, I think this is a win for Trump.
And relationships matter. This is, now you have someone in the room. They were both U.S. attorneys at the same time, Mueller in Massachusetts, Rudy in New York. They worked on some cases together in the region. Rudy obviously was mayor on 9/11. Bob Mueller was the FBI director. They worked together in the aftermath of that crisis. So they know each other. One would assume they have a professional relationship. The question is, to what end? Will it speed up at least the resolution of will or will not the president answer questions?
I don't know. I think there's a risk here of overpromising, right? And for all the good relationship that the president has with Rudy Giuliani, I think he sours very quickly if he feels like he's being had or he's being misled by people who are supposed to be helping him out. So that could be a problem.
And I think clearly how Giuliani approaches the issue of the Trump sit-down interview with Mueller is something that we're going to have to watch, because we've seen the shift in Trump's mind over the last several days after the raid on his personal lawyer's office last week, that he's kind of soured on sitting down with the special counsel for an interview. So does he change his mind now? How does Giuliani handle that? Will be something to watch.
And just to the point, a lot of people are saying that Rudy wanted this, that Rudy loves the spotlight, Rudy wanted this. Your colleague Maggie Haberman tweeting this last night. There's a belief Giuliani was like the Kool-Aid man bursting through the wall to join the Trump team. Four people close to the White House say he resisted joining, but Trump, wanting a big name who he's comfortable with, pushed for it.
Yeah, I think it's part of the, I agree with everything you said. It's part of the TV aspect of the Trump defense team. But here's the problem. One, I don't think Bob Mueller is going to be swayed by any sort of relationship that he may or may not have had. Two, this has been the White House approach the entire way. Oh, we're going to give you everything that you need, and then you just need to go away. And they keep giving it, and Mueller's not going away. We don't really know where Mueller's going, but I think that the idea that Rudy Giuliani can step in here and bring a conclusion to this is way out there.
Way out there, you think. Here's Christopher Ruddy's take, Newsmax executive, somebody the president calls quite frequently in the Washington Post, Sungmin. He says, what we've been seeing with the president is that he's picking A-level people that he knows are experienced but also know him well. One of the problems in the first year, we just went through this in the other conversation, one of the problems in the first year was that people didn't work out because they didn't know him and they didn't have experience for the position. So there's a comfort. The president, in a lot of his choices recently, wants a comfort level. Mm-hmm. The question is, comfort's one thing. Mm-hmm. Good legal representation and a resolution has been the giant thing the president can't get.
Exactly. And I'm not sure Bob Mueller cares too much about how comfortable Trump is with his own lawyer. So certainly it helps when the president is strategizing with his legal team about what to do. But in the context of the Mueller investigation, Bob Mueller is going to do what Bob Mueller is going to do. He's going to go on his own time frame. And I'm not sure how much the new representation changes that at all.
But there has been some talk among people who talk with the president outside of the White House and the West Wing in the last couple of weeks, some feeling that the president was getting very angry, getting very upset at a level that they had not seen in a long time, or maybe ever. Maybe having somebody, as Eliana said, somebody who's very close to him and who the president trusts, in many ways helps calm the president down. All this talk about, is he going to fire Rod Rosenstein? Is he going to try to fire Bob Mueller? This is the kind of thing that might tamp down any gestures toward that the president is making.
This is a dangerous question because it's the president we're talking about, this president we're talking about. But is he boxed in a sense, at least on the Mueller question, because Rudy Giuliani is on the record saying he's a man of great integrity. I've worked with him. He's trustworthy. He won't go rogue. He loves his country. That if you're going to, Rudy says, I don't want to have a special counsel, but if you're going to have one, this is the guy for it. Does that box the president in?
Well, I think the the president's legal team needs somebody to play the role of what Jim Mattis is doing in the cabinet, somebody who can tell the president things he doesn't agree with, but also bring the president along with him. So Mattis goes in to talk to the president and tells him, look, I know torture, I've seen torture, torture doesn't work. And Trump actually shifted his opinion on it. He said Mattis was very persuasive. Nobody knows quite why Mattis has this effect on the president. Part of it is that he's a general, part of it is that he doesn't air his disagreements in public. It's not clear to me if Rudy can actually play this role, and I think he'll have some ability to maneuver because he can now say, well, I've seen the details of the Mueller investigation, and I think he's made these missteps, and I think that will sort of allow him to loosen him and free himself from his past public comments. But somebody on the legal team, that's the role they've been missing, somebody who can dislodge the president from his previous views and move him toward a more reasonable position.
Oftentimes, though, guys who have a history of being the CEO, which Rudy had as the New York mayor, have a hard time going back to being on the staff. So we're going to watch. It'd be just an interesting dynamic to watch as this one plays out. Up next, we go west to Utah, where the map looks reliably red, yet the GOP civil war primed for a big weekend skirmish. Utah Republicans have a big convention this weekend, and you might say it's testing time for Mitt Romney. The 2012 GOP presidential nominee is now running for Senate. And in a year where they have so many challenges, one would think this would be a no-brainer for Republicans. Rally behind a tested candidate with a great fundraising network. Just check off Utah as a safe GOP hold. But Utah Republicans have a quite rowdy anti-establishment faction, and Romney not getting a free pass. CNN's Maeve Reston in Salt Lake City for the convention. Maeve, help us understand Romney's big challenge this weekend.
So we're expecting a potentially wild GOP convention this weekend because the party basically has been at war with itself for quite some time. Romney is going to be on the primary ballot here in Utah no matter what because he collected the requisite number of signatures. But there's been a big fight within the party between party activists and more establishment types over whether or not the party should continue to have this caucus process that will unfold on Saturday. So Romney is basically going for the party's nomination this weekend in the caucus voting, but he could potentially lose that fight because you have to clear 60% of the vote in order to go onto the ballot unchallenged. And there are 11 other people running against him and a lot of party activists who really don't want to see an establishment candidate put up as sort of the clear front runner for the Utah Republican Party.
Democracy in action.
That's the fight, John.
We'll watch that one play out over the weekend for Governor Romney. He wants to be Senator Romney. In addition to those internal tensions, Maeve, Utah also factors into the Democrats' math as they look to try to take back the House. Here's a question. Is Mia Love, she's a rising Republican star nationally, is she really in trouble back home?
She is. I'm going to spend a lot of time in that district later today and have been talking to voters there. And what's happened, she's always had really close races, but she is really one of these candidates who is laboring under the shadow of Donald Trump. He is not as popular here as he is in other red states, partly because of the huge Mormon population here who don't like his tone, particularly on immigration. And she has drawn a very charismatic opponent in Ben McAdams, who's the mayor of Salt Lake County. And he's going to give her a real run for her money. He has the ability to draw a lot of Republican support. And he's kind of this wonky, nerdy Democrat who's got a very bright future here in Utah. And it's going to be a very tight race.
Maeve Reston, I'm jealous. Enjoy the fun out in Utah this weekend. We'll talk to you afterwards, see what you find out there.
Thank you.
Maeve just talked about a strong Democratic candidate in Utah. Here's another way to understand why Republicans are worried about losing the House. Democrats are more than holding their own when it comes to fundraising. First, the basic balance of power. Democrats currently have 193 to 237 for the Republicans. But just look at how we rank the races so far. You can tell by looking at this, Republicans have a lot more of their races either in the lean or toss-up category than the Democrats do. So the Democrats start in stronger shape. Now look at this. Fundraising. This is among the 88 most competitive races. Now, a handful have not yet reported. But among the 88 competitive races where we have financial reports, look, the Democrats outraising their opponents in well in excess of more than half of those races. Advantage, Democrats. Now, let's look at a smaller subset here. These are races that are likely Republican, lean Republican, or toss-ups. And again, we're missing one report here. But among races, that most of which should be leaning to the right, the Democrats holding their own in the fundraising. Again, that's a bad challenge. That's bad news for the Republicans. Let's look at it this way. Among those 88 races, how many of them were the incumbents or trailing in fundraising? Only two Democratic incumbents in those most competitive races have been outraised by their opponents. 40 Republican incumbents have been outraised by their Democratic challengers, even though these guys, ladies, hold office. They should be able to raise more money. This is one of the reasons. A lot of people said Paul Ryan announced he's not running for re-election. Maybe he should step down as Speaker. It's one of the reasons Ryan says, no, you need me.
You all know that I came into this job as a policy guy, not a political guy, not a fundraiser. I have shattered every fundraising record any speaker has ever set. I came into this job with a speaker, with a goal of a speaker to raise $20 million. I doubled it to $40 million. Not only did I hit that goal, I hit it 8 months early. So there is nobody who's come close to being able to raise the kinds of funds I have and still can raise for this majority.
No matter how you look at it, a guy like Romney, you would think safe seat, just check the box, please, no controversy, let's move on. Strong candidates for the Democrats, the money numbers there. Let's start with Romney for a minute. This is where Mitch McConnell lost his best friend in the Senate, Robert Bennett. The Utah caucuses, the convention, turned against him. So welcome to the Tea Party, welcome to the grassroots activism out there, to the Senate. This is from Rod Arquette, who's a conservative talk radio host out there. It's about Romney. It's a mixed bag. Listeners raise the same questions. Romney and Romney care. His attack on President Trump during the campaign. The carpetbagger issue. So, you know, even in the Republicans likely to win this race, it's likely to be Mitt Romney, but you got to get bumped up along the way.
Yeah, there's no easy path for Republicans this year, and a year that kind of should be easy for them since the Democrats have such a disadvantage on the map. It just shows you how deep the dissatisfaction on the right is with people who are seem to be perceived to be establishment Republicans, and they just have to fight through this, and it's going to be happening around the country.
And you saw that with Jeff Flake in Arizona, felt like he couldn't run for re-election while still being a Trump critic. You saw Bob Corker out for similar reasons, and in Nevada, in Dean Heller, I mean, he has decided to take the calculus that he's just going to give the president a giant big hug and go for it that way, even though that is the toughest, one of the toughest states for Republicans to keep.
You mentioned Bob Corker. Mitch McConnell is mad at him again, or still, depending on your definition, because Bob Corker did a breakfast in town the other day, retiring Republican senator from Tennessee, and he said nice things about the Democrat, Phil Bredesen, running in that race. And so Bob Corker says really nice things about him. He's a nice guy. Republicans can vote for him. He's very effective. Good mayor, good governor, good business person. Mitch McConnell pulls him aside on the Senate floor. This in the Washington Post. McConnell told Corker his comments were unhelpful, both in the Tennessee race and in the larger battle for the Senate majority. McConnell also reminded Corker the Republicans were in the current situation only because Corker had decided to retire.
It's a friendly reminder from the Senate majority leader.
Unhelpful too. It's such a grade school
word.
Scolding. Yeah, very, very apt for the current situation. I find today's politics so interesting because the Tea Party had a clear ideological mooring in a certain way, where you knew you were going to get primaried and the issues would be your position on debt, deficits, they were animated by excess spending. Obama was a big part of it. And I think the objection to candidates today is less clear. Loyalty to the president is a part of it, but that doesn't have such clear ideological strictures to it. So I think these guys who are running, they get tagged as establishment, but it's not quite clear what that means. And the politics are very amorphous.
And on the fundraising thing, older Republicans who've been through this are freaked out by this because they have for months been telling these candidates, you need to raise more money, you don't understand this climate. And what they say they have is a number of especially relatively new House Republicans and their campaign teams who have only lived through the great Republican years. They've only lived through 2010 and 2014. And when the graybeards tell them, you don't understand what the other side wave looks like, they laugh at them and don't take it seriously. When you look at those fundraising numbers, if you have momentum and you have more money on the Democratic side, boom.
Yeah, but you also have to sort of understand or try to figure out where that money is going. For instance, big numbers for Beto O'Rourke, the Democrat challenging Ted Cruz. Now, there was a close poll for Beto O'Rourke, actually within the single digits of Ted Cruz, but most political observers think that that's a race that Ted Cruz may have some trouble in, but will probably win. A big fundraising haul for a race that Democrats are probably not going to win does sort of change how you analyze those big fundraising numbers. But I think they more reflect where the enthusiasm is, and that tells you maybe more about where the electorate is in November then sort of does it predict that Democrats will do better because they have a lot more money raised?
Although that number with the incumbents was startling. Yeah. I think we all looked at that.
Yeah. 40 incumbents. And that's only in the competitive races.
And
40 incumbents not raised.
Take the warning that you just mentioned. They don't take the warning. It's too late. And they go, well, what happened?
Well, having lived through a few tsunamis that go both ways, a lot of surprises with that. When we come back, Donald Trump is richer than you think. And somebody who sounds a lot like Donald Trump is going to tell you that. Welcome back. Topping our political radar today, Donald Trump, way before he was president, flat out lying to a Forbes magazine reporter to get on the magazine's prestigious list of super rich people. Who's claiming that he lied? The reporter, Jonathan Greenberg. He says Trump called him in 1984 pretending to be his own spokesman named John Barron. Listen to this.
Most of the assets have been consolidated to Mr. Trump, you know, because you have down Fred Trump. And I'd like to talk to you off the record if I can, just to make your thing easier.
Okay, sure.
Is that all right?
Yeah, that's fine.
All right, but I think you can really use Donald Trump now, and you can just consolidate. I think last year somebody showed me the article, and I think you had 200 and 200. And really, it's been pretty well consolidated now for the most part. As I also think somebody had mentioned that you had asked about that, or somebody had, and it's been pretty well consolidated. Okay?
Okay. Well, the governor of Colorado not happy with rising crime rates, and he might think it's related to legal marijuana in his state. The Democratic governor, John Hickenlooper, says he's not going to make pot use illegal again right now, but he won't rule it out. Crimes are up in Colorado, even though nationally they're trending down. Colorado officials say they're going to study that data. And at least one high school student is wounded and a suspect in custody, that after a shooting at a high school in Ocala, Florida today. A somber reminder. The 19th anniversary of the Columbine High School massacre is today. The shooting also comes on a day when high schoolers across the country are participating in a national school walkout, a protest against gun violence. And as Jason Carroll, live in Washington Square Park in New York, what are the students telling you, Jason? Look at that. It's a big crowd.
Huge crowd, and let me tell you, they are motivated, they are angry, they want to see stricter gun control policy put forth. They say they're not going to stop until they see that get done. I want to show you the crowd here that's packed into Washington Square Park. Thousands of students here now listening to speakers. Organizers expected some 5,000 students to show up from at least 30 different schools. The Department of Education sending out a note saying, look, if you come out to this protest, you will be marked as absent. You will be penalized for coming out here. I spoke to the mayor's office about that, John. The mayor's office said, look, we appreciate these students coming out to voice their opinions, to express their point of view, but we want to see them have a full day of school. The students have remained undeterred by that. They say this is not about missing a day of school. This is about stricter gun policy. The big question here, John, is when I'm speaking to a lot of these students, I say, you've got some of this momentum now. What are you going to do to carry it forward? Will you be able to sustain this through the midterm elections? They're saying here today they're confident they'll be able to do that. John?
Jason Carroll in the masses for us. Jason, appreciate that reporting. And let's bring it back into the room here. Whatever your views on gun control, whether you think we should have more laws, whether you think the laws are fine, whether you think we should have fewer laws, I'm a fan of democracy. And if I were in high school, getting a little time out of school might not be so bad either. But the persistence is the question. You know, the Parkland students came to Washington. Students around the country supported them. There was a divide even among them over everything Congress should do. They weren't in total agreement with what Congress should do. But Congress didn't do anything in the gun control arena, and that these students are still back at it. Florida has passed a new gun safety law that includes money for school safety, but also new gun controls. The Republican governor signed that. He's going to test the politics of that in a Senate race this year. Vermont, another big gun rights state, passed new gun controls as well. Nationally, there's no disagreement, right? This is done. We're done with this issue in Washington for the year. But what? What is the next test for these students and what they want?
The next test to see if they can make it an electoral issue, because you're right that this issue has basically dissipated from Congress's radar. A massive spending bill that the Congress passed in March had a few very modest gun-related restrictions in it. We were talking about the Fix-Nix Act, which is that legislation that essentially streamlines and improves the background check system, but that's the furthest that this Republican Congress is going to go. So it's really whether these students and the broader gun control activists can mobilize in these districts and make it an electoral issue. Obviously, Rick Scott will be a test of that, and these other swing districts where they are kind of spanning out and saying, you have to, this is going to be a voting issue.
It could also flip the other way. I mean, this is we've seen this in the past decade, where every time there's an effort or the sense that there might be an effort in Washington to restrict gun rights and the ability to get a gun, you see gun owners come out to the polls. We saw this in efforts by cities and local governments to do this that were roundly and soundly defeated. And I think it does cut the other way. You can look at, maybe perhaps point at the generic ballot actually shrinking a little bit in Republicans' favor. This is an issue that motivates another half of the country as well. And if it becomes a political issue for liberals on gun control, it could very well become a political issue for conservatives and perhaps be more potent.
Well, if it brings more people out to vote, whatever their positions, I'm for it then. If more people would actually vote, that would be a decent thing.
Well, what I think is interesting is that for a long time, the pro-gun side of this debate has been more passionate, more politically active, more mobilized. I think we're starting
more effective.
I think we're starting to see a little bit of a change in that, with questions about how effective gun control activists will be. But I think the effects will be long-term. So 10 or 20 years from now, are gun control activists, are they able to match the effectiveness of gun enthusiasts?
Well, let me stop and add this question just into us. Michael Cohen's lawyer went to court today trying to stop, get a pause, a delay in the Stormy Daniels suit. She's suing in California. It's about the non-disclosure agreement. There's a big debate about that. But in asking for the delay today, Michael Cohen's attorney said that delay was necessary because his client could be indicted within the next 90 days. Michael Cohen's own lawyer walking into a courtroom and telling a judge, we can't process this case right now because there's a federal criminal investigation against me in New York and my client could be indicted in 90 days. So Brent Blakely, the lawyer, asking for a 90-day stay essentially to let the dust settle in New York. Is that just a smart legal tactic to get your delay, or is that Michael Cohen's lawyers publicly saying what a lot of people anticipate, that the feds would not have gone to the lengths they have gone to if they didn't have a strong case?
I think that this has been the common perception among attorneys and prosecutors around here and in New York, that there is an imminent indictment just based on the length of the investigation, the amount of surveillance that was involved. I do think it's, you know, he's trying to get out of all these lawsuits right now so they can focus on the criminal one up there. And I think it's just a really great illustration of how serious this is for Michael Cohen and probably for his clients.
And Michael Avenatti, Stormy Daniels' lawyer, has said the same thing. Michael Cohen's lawyer at one point saying even he thinks that. So again, does he have information that's credible, that it's going to happen, or does he just think it's reasonable that might happen given the Fed case? We'll continue to track that. We're going to take a quick break. We'll be right back.